Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all to the second session of the day, the afternoon session. It is our immense pleasure to have with us Dr. Gadadhar Das, Professor, Department of Aquatic Animal Health, Faculty of Fishery Sciences, West Bengal University of Animal and Fishery Sciences, Kolkata. Sir has chosen a topic of deliberation, recent advances in fishland shrimp health management for sustainable aquaculture. Sir, you are audible as well as visible. Also, your presentation is visible and the session has been started to be recorded. Please continue and start, sir.
Okay, thank you. So, very good afternoon to all dear participants. I am privileged to be here in this visual platform to share some of my experience with regard to fish and shrimp health management for sustainable aquaculture. So health management is the key for sustainable aquaculture. So when we'll talk about sustainability and aquaculture, and we cannot ignore health management. So why aquaculture? And then question comes, it's sustainability and the other aspects. Let us talk about these things for coming about 1 hour, what is assigned to me, and let me have a talk. Let us see this regarding aquaculture. Why aquaculture? I have told, if we will think about the conversion efficiency, the cattle's around 10 to 12 kg of feed is required to produce 1 kg of beef. Around 4 to 5 kg of feed is required to produce 1 kg of pork. And around 1 to 1.5 kg of feed is required to produce 1 kg of fish. You see, and with regard to emissions, if you think, emissions of nitrogenous and metabolic products, nitrogenous metabolic products and phosphorus things, cattle produces highest, followed by pig, followed by poultry, followed by fish, and then bivalves. So much is the importance. So we can see from this bar diagram or from this graph that fish can give a very sustainable production to the protein hunger people of the globe, which expects 9 to 10 billion people at the end of 2030 to 50. And their seafood estimated demand may be 261 million tons. So to meet such type of things, definitely we have to increase the productions. Once we increase the production, definitely we'll invite so many other complications like diseases. So let us have some talk about the world average per capita consumptions. If we'll think about the world average per capita consumptions, is around, it is oscillating between 11.5 kg per annum to 16.7, almost in between this era. So definitely our per capita consumption has been increased, and but if you think about India and China, our per capita consumption is much lower compared to China. Our per capita consumption of India with regard to fish and fishery products is 12 kg only, whereas China, it is around 26.1 kg, which is highest in the world. So you see the difference. See the difference. So it will think about the species cultured. About 580 species are being cultured. And out of these 580 species, 362 fin fishes, including the hybrids, 104 molluscs and 62 crustaceans, 6 frogs and reptiles, 9 aquatic invertebrates, and 37 aquatic plants. So these many numbers of aqua species are being cultured. So much diversifications in culture species. If you think about the top 12 aquaculture producers, that is again China and India. China is producing about 49.2 million tons, which costs about 144.7 billion US dollar, and whereas India produces around 6 million tons, 5.7 million tons, costs about 10.6 billion US dollar. So the simple question is that why China is producing so much more? It is the answer may be they are adopting all modern technology with automations, where we Indian people, we have enough resources. We are blessed with several types of resources also, but we are still producing much less. To think about the global aquaculture productions, again, the freshwater fishes contributes little more, that is 44.6 million metric tons, whereas other species like aquatic plants and marine animals contribute less. And total contribution is around 111.912 metric tons. People think about aquaculture, which is a very dynamic and fragile sector. It is very much site or location specific. Just now I was telling about aquaculture is blessed. We are bestowed with several resources. We have oceanic resources, marine resources. We have estuaries, lakes. We have deals, varies, mudflats. We have varies. We have ponds, tanks, several other resources. And our farmers are also very much innovative. They have gone with several innovative technology to produce more and more. And going to produce more and more invites the diseases. Just a morning, Dr. Abraham was also telling the same first basic principle of this genesis of disease, that is disease manifestation is an interactions of post ecological agent as well as stress square. By inviting the higher productions, we are stressing the environment, we are increasing the number of different types of stressors, and thereby it leads to the occurrence of several types of diseases. So this is what Snisco 1974, which is the pioneer model of genesis of diseases. Okay. If you think about the diseases, it may be infectious disease, maybe non-infectious disease, maybe parasitic disease, maybe viral, maybe opportunistic disease like bacterial, fungal, and maybe exotic diseases, maybe emerging diseases, maybe obligatory diseases. Several different types of diseases are there. So we'll discuss some of these diseases also. Diseases of infectious in aquaculture, particularly, it can be categorized into three categories: the exotic diseases, endemic diseases, and emerging diseases. When you think about exotic diseases, and exotic diseases, it is very much important to trade. And as because we are dealing with this aquaculture and related products, we are mainly concerned with the live feed organisms or these live organisms. Many a times we are importing and exporting the live organisms, particularly the ornamental fishes and many other fishes of commercial importance also. So that is governed by the international standards. Set of criteria are to be met to include these list of pathogens also. So several types of day by day, we are adding one after another pathogens in our microbial pathogen list. This is with regard to exotic. We have porous border also. We are sharing our border with Bangladesh. We are sharing border our Nepal. We are sharing our border with China and several other countries also. So, and also we are importing and exporting to many countries, and we are importing also, we are exporting also these live organisms. So there is every chance that we are getting the diseases, and we are also spreading the diseases throughout the world. And with regard to endemic diseases, particularly consistently, it is there, particularly bacterial disease, parasitic disease, fungal disease, viral disease, they're still there in our culture systems, in our grow out, nursery, hatchery. At all levels, these endemic diseases are there, and we have to struggle, we have to fight with these diseases. And with regard to emerging diseases, many known and unknown etiologies are there, emerging diseases. So they are with new geographical areas, new susceptible species, and many new diseases are there. We'll talk about these things in subsequent slides. So this slide was somewhat a little repetition of the earlier presenter, Dr. Abraham, but I will just twist some of these points. Like fission status is an factor which is being affected by the host, by the host facilities, environment, nutrition, pathogen, and physiological status. And this host again it is species, age, and strength specific. Okay. So again, the facilities, how this handling and density, how much density we are talking, what is the design of the farm, etc. So all these things depends on fish health, depends upon this environment, organic load, water quality, temperature. All these are highly related to the fish health. And with regard to nutrition, the quality, quantity, and the schedule is very important. With regard to pathogen, strain, type, and species is also important. And physiological status, acquired immunity, natural resistance are also of very much pivotal concern. So this in total, in general, it contributes to the fish health. People think about the climate change and aquaculture. Climate change has a pivotal role in governing the different types of diseases. As you know, just I will tell you one important disease of OI listed disease, that is the U.S. epidemic ulcer tick syndrome. This usually takes place soon after the monsoon, and as the winter approaches and the monsoon will go, at that time we will find that this type of disease, that is ulcerative conditions in the fishes, particularly carps and morels and several other species in the ponds, tanks, and the bills, and several other areas including rivers also sometimes. And this is a very good example of climate change. Also, nowadays we are facing several other types of mortalities due to climate change, due to sudden change of temperature, due to sudden change of salinity. We are facing also the problems. Sudden change of temperature, there is a mass mortality, and many times farmers are reporting about the mass mortality due to the sudden change of temperature, maybe due to the formation of thermocline, maybe due to they are not cope up with the higher temperature. Okay. So these are some of these climate related changes and the disease and mortality also. And what are the factors leading to the discovery of new and emerging aquatic animal diseases? The first and foremost thing is the increased aquaculture production. We are greedy enough to produce more and more without thinking about its sustainability. So we are stocking more and more without taking appropriate measures for maintaining this higher stocking. And expanding the range of new farmed aquatic animal species. We are adding more and more number of species to our native species. We are adding Amur, we are adding Banami, we are adding several other species also from the other countries. And without studying their biology properly, without thinking about the future consequence, and now what we are facing with the Banami also. New production approaches, such as integrated multi-trophic aquaculture, new production approaches. Our farmers, our industry people, they are thinking about producing more through several approaches like bioflocks, RAS systems, and several other ways also they are producing day by day. They want to produce more and more. Improved diagnostics and surveillance efforts. This I want to little have a talk regarding improved diagnostics. You see, with regard to corona, if you think, testing efforts we are increasing, so we are getting positives or negatives more and more. So similarly, as because we are increasing our surveillance efforts, now we are getting more and more types of diseases. And you know, after 2010, perhaps Government of India has set up the idea of putting the surveillance in aquaculture systems, and which is enforced by OIE and NACA. And accordingly, Government of India has enforced and they set up a mega projects of, that is, National Surveillance Program for Aquatic Animal Diseases, NASPOD, throughout the country. 42 centers are being involved to get these surveillance reports. And this surveillance report, first phase 5 years has been covered. And out of that report, perhaps three more infectious diseases have been identified, that is, Haemophilus virus 2 and the Tilapia lecterns virus and IMN infectious myonucleosis virus. In stream. Through this active passive surveillance, reporting, compilations, and zonations can be created. Even Government of India sometimes made the task force to combat over the different diseases in different corners of the country. So this is now aquaculture is in the eye of strong surveillance. So all the state governments, all these central government organizations, they are trying their level best to identify the different diseases occurring in the different areas, and they are reporting in time also, in time to the respective agencies. Then spreading the aquatic animal diseases. So different types of diseases of concern, economic concern, like white spot syndrome disease, Taura syndrome, gyrodactylosis, sleeping sickness disease, EHN, epigenetic hematopoietic necrosis virus disease, SBC, spring pyramidicarp, Puy herpes virus, and infectious salmon anemic disease, or anemia, salmon anemia virus. So these diseases are spreading in the aquatic environment. If you think about this aquatic animal diseases, OI, Office International Epigenetics, the headquarters Paris, it has been enlisted the different diseases, that is epigenetic ulcerative syndrome, epigenetic hematopoietic necrosis, gyrodactylosis, infectious hematopoietic necrosis, like this, several pinfish diseases, molluscan diseases, crustacean diseases, as well as amphibian diseases. And besides that, the diseases of national concern, that is non-OI listed diseases, has been reported. And actually, after 2010, pathologists of all over the country, they said, along with the representatives from NACA, as well as from OI experts, so they have categorized the different diseases of economic concern. And they have put forth these diseases like vectorial kidney disease, even arbolosis, myxoboliosis, and ergosilosis, and several other diseases. And under this finfish, and even crustacean disease like acute pyramidal necrosis in scallops, like monodont sloganoff syndrome, then spherical baculovirus disease, tetradal baculovirus disease, then microsporidiosis, carnosinity. These all these diseases are of national concern, are of economic value. That has been also enlisted. And next, we'll go for what are the TADs, transboundary aquatic animal diseases. Transboundary, just now I was telling, we are sharing the border with many countries, which is very much porous. And these diseases are highly contagious and transmissible, that is infectious. And we do not have any control over these porous borders to have a check over these organisms which are being exported or imported. We listed about 30 different aquatic pathogens and diseases, which is a fit to be established criteria for listed diseases in terms of consequence, spread, and diagnosis. Okay. One negative impacts of trade globalization, so that is transboundary. We are inviting several types of diseases through the boundary. Okay. And some better examples of these TADs, that is transboundary aquatic animal disease, that is epigenetic ulcer syndrome, tilapia leptic virus, acute hematopoietic, hepatopancreatic necrosis disease, and infectious myonecrosis virus disease, then Puy herpes virus disease. If you think about this epigenetic ulcerative syndrome, many scientists, many school of thoughts are coming. Some are telling bars are the carrier organisms, some are telling through water it is coming. We see now we have this river linking process. So through that is possibility of transmissions. Now this 1971, EU started its journey, and now it has reached in Africa. Okay. And it has devastated, it has set the backbone of fisheries industry in 90s. Now at least many curative measures, many attempts have been made to have a control over this EUS. Similarly, now tilapia leptic virus and upon as well as the IMNB, as well as Puy herpes virus is creating several problems, okay, in aquaculture sectors. Then some of these drivers and factors affecting the emergent diseases in aquaculture, and if you think about these drivers, it is a highly traded commodity, and a hyper diverse species range. I have already told you more than 580 species are being cultured. So there is possibility of transmission of various diseases, because we cannot have so much control over so many variety of diseases. And these are live animals, larvae, fry, and adults, and their products. They are like live, fresh, frozen, and they are also traded internationally. Many species are found outside of the native range. Then invasive animals and pathogens can be traded with primary host. Then ornamental aquaculture trade is also a large, large and a growing trade globally now. Some other drivers are factors which are affecting the emerging diseases, like it is a unique aquatic system and the slow collective awareness of the new threats, lack of basic pathogen data. We do not have data of pathogens. It's aquaculture data of pathogens. Gradually, now through NASPOTS, we are getting the list of pathogens which are there in the in our country. So lack of basic host data, then diagnostic focused on the known or listed diseases, that is also very much poor. Then breeding strategies are not been not in place for many species, particularly SPF, SPR and SPT stocks and selective breeding. We are not able to produce all these SPF, SPR, and we are selectively, mostly we are getting these SPF stocks again through RGCA only. So misuse of stocks, that is SPF stocks in some cases. Okay, then limited availability of vaccines. Already we have told very limited number of vaccines are available, commercial vaccines, all are vaccines sort of available that are mostly for temperate countries. Then societal barriers also to innovative control and surveillance. Many societal barriers are there also. Our farmers, they are not too willing to adopt so many innovative technology because of several societal barriers, even societal barriers for innovative genetics, GMO, genetically modified organisms. So many problems are there for bitcotton and brinjal. Also, several they say now people have several objections or barriers against also genetically modified aquatic organisms also. Then again, here another multiple institutions involved in aquatic health management. The competent authority is a question mark. Here, let me say, we do not have a specific regulatory authority. But like that of human beings, we are following the regulatory measures for this FDA, that is Food and Drug Controller of US. We do not have that much this regulatory authority in India, at least towards the end of this NASPO program. This CAA, Coastal Aquaculture Authority, as well as PASAI, that is Food Standards and Specifications Delhi, they have taken some steps, and they are regulating some of these industry products. Then inadequate and poor implemented biosecurity. Our biosecurity is not also properly maintained. And then inconsistent or weak implementation of international standards. We are not able to meet up these international standards in many cases. So most of the times we are sending our products, particularly our shrimp products, to Vietnam and other countries. We are getting less price where these international standards are little poor. They are not seeing the things. But if we send to US and Japan, we can get a little more, but we have to maintain the standard. Perceived low incentive report of known and emergent diseases. Then weak regulatory framework, public-private sector. Then mismatch of research agenda and the farmer community and sector. Actually, this is a big thing. Our need of the farmer is something else, and our research, we are doing something else. When this research priority, as well as the farmer's priority, will be in the equilibrium or will be same or will be known to each other, then perhaps most of the things can be solved, and we can develop, our sector can be developed. Next, some other drivers and factors affecting the emergent disease. I can tell you this: physical and chemical conditions in aquaculture are often are suboptimum for the host. Then aquatic hosts are cold-blooded and also responsive to stressors. These cold-blooded animals, they are also more prone to various types of stress. Then animals may be farmed outside, okay, and then aquatic medium is pathogen rich and diverse dependence with the environmental conditions. These aquatic medium also a pathogen rich and can spread very quickly compared to the terrestrial medium. And the pathogen involved are spillover and spillback related to the wild populations. Some hosts like crustaceans and mollusks must calcify. So that is obvious calcifications of this molluscan host. And then what we can do, before the disease or after the disease, whether we should go for prevention or we can go for cure. Prevention is always better than cure. That this proverb is always true. That is, teeth in time saves nine. The proactive approach, definitely it is better than the reactive approach. And this prevention and proactive approach is always less costly than the curative approach, that is solution, and the reactive approach, that is, and that cost little more. Here the equilibrium is, one pebble can be able to take the weight of these three pebbles. So that is cure. Prevention is always better than the cure. So what that is to be taken at the appropriate time and appropriate phase. So if the prevention will be taken at appropriate time and appropriate phase, perhaps our things we can save. So managing the risks at all levels of aquaculture chain, whether it is hatchery, whether it is nursery, grow out, processing plants, or even markets, or even risky areas in the value chain, suppliers of input and the products, trading the practices, etc. So we have to manage the risk at all the levels of the aquaculture chain. Then and there only we can think about the sustainability of aquaculture. We can think about the sustainable aquaculture. Then let us discuss about these different levels of disease diagnosis. Morning little thing has been discussed. I will just focus a little more. They say we have three levels of diagnosis, level one, level two, level three. And most of these laboratories say they are maintaining this level one and level two diagnosis. Level one, that is gross examinations and clinical signs, and level two, this histopathology, hematology, wet mounts, basic bacteriology, parasitology, and mycology, etc. All the things and that will come under level two. Most of the laboratories, they are coming under level this level two. Many other laboratories, they have the facility for molecular methods like PCR, RT-PCR, in situ hybridizations, ELISA, and several serological tests. So in India, at least 3-4 laboratories, they are being identified by these authorities. So like SIPA, SIBA, like RGCA, like CFRI, so like CIFT. So they are considered as the referral laboratories, and they are maintaining all level three. They have all level three facilities. So most of the times, many other laboratories, they are taking the help of these referral laboratories for confirmations of their results, what they are getting at level two. Okay. So next, fundamentals of disease transmission. So we have to find out who is the culprit. And we have to look into the eye of a doctor, eye of a scientist, whether the fish is the culprit, whether the insect is the culprit, whether the shrimp is the culprit, whether any other organism is the culprit. We have to find out if any other vector is the culprit. How the disease comes into the aquaculture systems. Who is the culprit? We have to identify it very correctly. Then disease introductions, maybe through the fish movement, incoming fish, maybe through eggs also, maybe through water resources. Fish health may be deteriorated. Equipments through vehicles also, vectors. So all these things has to be watched very thoroughly and in the eye of a doctor or eye of a scientist. If these things will be looked into very seriously, then we can avoid many diseases, occurrence of many diseases. And regarding transmission, we have two types of transmission. One is horizontal transmission, another is vertical transmissions. Horizontal transmissions from pond to pond, from one area to another area, from one farm to other farm, and that may be from one pond to other pond, maybe through use of these nets, maybe through buckets, vehicles, and common facilities which are being used within the farm. And when you think about the vertical transmission, maybe from parents to offsprings, through the fecal matter, through the sex products, okay? And this is from parents to offsprings, okay? So we have to find out whether it is horizontal transmission or vertical transmission. Most of the hereditary diseases are through these vertical transmissions. Most of these communicable diseases are through horizontal transmissions. Okay, health control in aquaculture. Then we have to think about the improved nutrition and use of probiotics, improved disease resistance, quality control of water, seed, feed, use of immunostimulants, then rapid detection of pathogens through use of affordable vaccines and reduction of the use of antibiotics also. So we have to say, then diagnostic tests. we have to screen and diagnose in a correct manner. So we have to identify the infected fish and brought to the laboratory in the live conditions or in the moribund conditions. Then we have to check the infection level. We'll see the historical development of this laboratory diagnosis from culture-based assays to the nucleic acid-based diagnosis. Just to start with this, I was telling the recent developments. The conventional technologies for identifying the disease has been changed to the molecular level, particularly nucleic acid-based diagnosis. The conventional ways are nothing but this cultures, gram stain, biochemical, serological tests, etc. Then various mycological tests, various these hematological tests, and various histopathological tests are also being done for as conventional methods. These conventional methods are being changed, are being diverted now into DNA sequencing, next gen sequencing, etc. Then PCR, qPCR, RT-PCR, etc. Then all these new and standard methods and rapid techniques are being used for diagnosis, and this gives a lot of accuracy and specificity, and also the rapidity in the diagnosis can save the crop like anything, because earlier conventional methods took a lot of time for diagnosis, for confirmations. However, detection of pathogens, however, I can tell you the earlier, just to elaborate the things, earlier these morphological and traditional methods, culture, histology, just through petri plates, histology, clinical observations, gross observations, and through that we are confirming that, okay, this the region. So we are prescribing, or we are telling that, okay, you can go for application of this or that. Then gradually, then this morphological traditional methods have been changed to immunological methods, and through the different serological tests like ELISA, like Western blots, and several other methods are being used to find out the accuracy of the traditional methods. Then this also, this has been again rectified through the molecular means, through the DNA sequencing, that is gel electrophoresis documentations, etc. Then this microarrays and this next gen sequencing, these are the new, and bioinformatics has come into picture to find out the different models, and also sometimes we are able to produce forecast the occurrence of disease. We are able to forecast the occurrence of disease. Now we are producing the disease calendars also. Okay, then to my mind, it is better, always better combination of methods, combination of the traditional methods as well as the conventional methods, as well as the advanced methods, is a useful tool or useful technique to solve the purpose or to have the advent of the sustainable aquaculture. Methods to be robust, but yet to be sensitive. Methods to be robust, but yet to be sensitive. First, the sensitiveness of the method of diagnosis is very important. Diagnosis, moreover, diagnosis is more important than the treatment. If you can diagnose properly, we can go for treatment. Medicines are available, or treatment procedures are available. So just we have to diagnose what exactly happens, whether it happens to water, whether it happens to soil, whether it happens to the fish or shrimp, then that has to be identified. And then once the route is identified, then it is not far off to find out the way to cure it. Examples of novel technology with potentially is like immunoassays, fluorescent body tests, fat, and immunohistochemistry, enzyme linked immunosorbent, that is ELISA, then dot blots, then Western blots, etc. I have already told you molecular tests like real time PCR, nucleic acid based amplification, that is then nested PCR, then RT-PCR, then your next gen sequencing. All these things, these novel technologies are available for identification of different types of diseases in a very short span of time. So regarding lateral flow device, that is immunochromatography, that is liquid chromatography, paper chromatography, are also being very much sensitive, and they are used. That gives the rapid result. Here also, they say monoclonal antibody and polyclonal antibody tests are being used to identify this infectious salmon, this anemic virus, and this gives a good result regarding nanotechnology. And now this various novel technologies you are discussing, this nanomaterials are being used. Now various company products are coming with nano sachets are available. Nano sachets are available for boosting of the planktons. Various drugs and chemicals are of nanoparticle based. They say now gold and silver are being frequently used in aquatic field, but beside that also nickel, tungsten are being used as nanoparticles, but still it is not frequently in the practice. And however, the different practical applications of nanotechnology, aquaculture, the water and wastewater remediations through the nanotechnology is possible. Disinfection, sterilization, disinfection of water, disinfection of soil, then sterilization, detoxification, and monitoring all through the use of nanotechnology products. Almost all these what products, most of these company products now, some sensitive company products, so they are of nano waste. Organizing performance and health in terms of vaccination, drug delivery, monitoring, and then antimicrobial applications are also nano waste. Reproduction control and functional for feeding also nanotechnology based. That is possible. Harvested of fish manufacturing, preservation, packaging, commercialization, nanotechnology products are being very frequently used. Then regarding biosensor as fish health assessment tool. Regarding biosensor applications in aquatic field is not so much used. So now it has not been commercialized also, but it is very much frequently used in human sector or medical field. You know, pregnancy tests and glucose tests and this hemoglobin tests, many other tests are only biosensor based. Now, keeping the principle same, the scientists say they are in the process to develop the biosensors, and I will tell you to inform this. CEDAC Kolkata, as well as this IIT Hyderabad and CP Barakpur, through a mega project, they are going to develop certain biosensors. Fortunately, we are part of that program, and that biosensors are already been developed. Only the miniature model has to develop, and it has to be tested in Assam, and we have requested them also to test in Bengal. Okay, this is very good. And through biosensors, we can test the presence of heavy metals, we can test the presence of pesticides, we can test the presence of certain bacteria. Okay, so it is possible, but still it is not in commercial phase. It is still in the experimental stage, but we hope and soon it will come to the field within a short span of time. And with regard to laboratory diagnosis tests, nucleic acid based assays, first screening, surveillance, then discovery, pathogen detections, then confirmed test through various these methods, PCR, RT-PCR, and various qPCR, etc., and sequencing different methods also are there. Through that, the confirmatory tests can be done. Regarding serological tests, already we have talked, and ELISA is a very good technique, followed by Western blots and dot blots are also there. Then regarding fish vaccines, two vaccines earlier were there in 1902, and now it is 2007, 26 vaccines. But most of these vaccines are of temperate countries. Perhaps none of the vaccines are available, and most of these vaccines also, they are, though it gives the environmental benefits, annual welfare benefits, and economy benefits, but it is not possible because of several factors. The countries like Norway, Sweden, and Japan, they have all facilities for commercial applications of these vaccines. They have automations, so they can vaccinate a number of pieces within short time. They have all facilities, but in our systems, perhaps it is not so easy. You know, to develop a vaccines for corona, our scientists, our whole world scientists, and it's not so easy also. It is not so easy, just you see, and it is not an easy task to develop a vaccine. Need to identify the protective pathogens. It is like finding a needle in the haystack. Okay, so it is very difficult to find a vaccine against certain pathogens. It is really, really Herculean task. Though vaccines are available in the simple inactivated form, recombinant form, and this BLP vaccine, the virus-like particles, live modified vaccines, eco vaccines, and the DNA vaccines, gene silencing, etc. Those several methods are there for preparation of vaccines, starting from inactivation to recombinant DNA and gene silencing. But still, our vaccine technology in case of India, particularly in a CARP country like India, it has not been taken a good step. So regarding challenges faced by the diagnostic labs, for particularly if we'll think about the different challenges in the aquatic animal diseases, getting the samples is a real challenge. Getting the samples is a real challenge. Reliable detection of pathogen is difficult also. If the clinically sick aquatic animals are not available. So getting the samples is really difficult, and also need cost-effective, fast, highly sensitive and specific method that allow the unbiased pathogen detections. And usually all these methods are little costly. No perfect method. Assay development is a never-ending process. Then prevalence of animal disease changing depending upon the time of the year and water temperature. This is another important factor. This is related to the aquatic environment. So success in disease management is a little problematic, and the need for curing tests, that means quantitative assessment tests. Then pathogen controls are also expensive and not so easy to get all those things. So these are some of these problems faced by the diagnostic labs. And if we think about the preventive health management, it is the BMPs, better management practices, code of conduct, and the good aquaculture practices and biosecurity governance. So if you think about this, preventing the entry of infectious agents to the farm environment, it is the use of disease-free stocks like SPF, SPT, and SPR stocks. And then we'll think of about the pond preparations, management points, pond preparations, maintain good water quality, good nutrition, optimal feeding rate, low stock intensity, monitor stock and environment. We should also think about sterilization, disinfections, and water treatment, disinfection, and exclusion of wild fish, birds, and sterilization of equipment, etc. Because there is possibility of entry of pathogens through various means. So we have to take care for all. Then and there only it is possible to prevent the entry of the infectious agents. Otherwise, there is possible that they can enter through any means. And with regard to fish health management, chemotherapy, vaccinations, farm management, nutritional management. So these things have already been discussed in the first half. So I'm not going to discuss these things in a bit largely. So with regard to probiotics applications, let me tell you about, we have three types of probiotics, that is soil, water, and feed probiotics. Mostly for soil probiotics in case of shrimp culture and fish culture also we'll talk. And 1.5 kg per acre we can apply, and 10 kg per hectare, and maximum 100 kg per hectare in total culture period we should give, not more than that. And it again depends upon the concentration of the beneficial bacteria and slush conditions also, okay. And nevertheless, we should use these probiotics in a combined way. The water probiotics and feed probiotics should not be combined and should be given at one time. Because suppose water is in the deteriorated condition, we have to rectify the water conditions, water quality, then we have to apply water probiotics, and that to the prescribed dose, that is 0.5 to 1.0 kg per hectare per week. Okay. Again, suppose feed probiotics, we can give 0.01 to 0.4 kg per gram per kg feed with a suitable binder. Okay, so these are the different probiotics we can use, and particularly these are the this we are prescribing for the shrimp pills. Also immunostimulants, where this we are not using any antibiotics in case of which is not prescribed. So immunostimulants are the only options, probiotics and immunostimulants. Particularly beta glucans are more of use in the shrimp pills, and 100 milligram per kg feed we can use, or 2 to 5 kg per ton of feed we can use. Kg to, and also along with that we can use levamisil, lentinon, polysaccharides, and oligosaccharides, sizofilan, vitamin C, E, cations, chitin, and chitosans. So vitamins and minerals, stress metals, but we should be sure to give not less or not more, because medicines double-edged swords. Once you give more, also it is problematic. It will kill the organisms. Once you give less, also it is problematic. It will not work. So we should be cautious to give adequate amount of these drugs or chemicals, and that will yield the effect. And with regard to prevention, just it will squeeze, because prevention is on one hand, and that you can prevent it by if you squeeze this doll, you will see that squeeze means you can prevent the management practices, you can have a control over the ideal water treatment and also feed, seed, etc. Then you will get a very good doll in the left hand. Okay, so you have to prevent like this. Okay, so if you prevent, then you can get the good crop. Okay, next, preventive measures. What is prevention? It is nothing but to avoid the threat before it occurs. To avoid the threat before it occurs, that is in terms of water quality, genetics, and immunizations, feed quality, reduce the density, reduce the stress, dietary supplements, and early application of antimicrobials. Okay, so when you think about this preventive measures, we have to these all the factors, they contribute in total about keeping the fish healthy by adopting these measures. Okay, so next, the protective measures. Protective measures means what does it mean? The next step, and usually takes over if the prevention fails. If the prevention fails, then you can think of about the protective measures. Okay, under the protective measures, these are the different components, that is transplant regulations, hygiene, vector and pest control, SPF feed, SPF stocks, and then control of wild fishes, quarantine, age segregations, and size specifications. All these things should be taken into account. But one thing, that even prevention and protections is not, if it fails, then and there only we can think of about chemotherapy or treatment. Chemotherapy or treatment, if it is warranted, we should go. Otherwise, it is better to have these protective measures, preventive measures, and followed by protective measures. Okay. So I hope if you will take these preventive and protective measures, the things will be okay, or the system will be okay, and it will not warrant the applications of this chemo. But many times, these things we are preventing, we are avoiding, we are escaping, so that we are facing these problems. And we'll think about the better management practices. BMP are the set of management guidelines. We have to follow these management guidelines in a robust way. Okay, then and there only we can able to achieve and the production without any incurring any loss. Then good aquaculture practices, the implementation of good aquaculture practices, that is biosecurity maintenance in the farming system, depends mainly on the system, the species, recommended stocking season, as well as the region where the farming is conducted. Okay, so depending upon the four characters or the four components, this year good aquaculture practices depends. Okay, so next we will go for biosecurity. If you think about biosecurity, reducing and managing the risks, it is prevention, mitigation, and coping. So you think about these biosecurity principles. If you think about these biosecurity principles, then identify the diseases of concern, review the management practices, create the farm design and diagram, and identify the risk, then select the biosecurity and the best practices. So if you overall think about these biosecurity plans, then particularly starting with the pond preparations, then the use of SPF seeds, then ward and crop fencing, particularly these are the biosecurity measures for shrimp farming, and these are the disinfections of the different nets, then use of rubber boots and shoes outside, then disinfections of the vehicles, etc. So you see, thinking of all these things, and I'll tell you one thing, nowadays these importers from these abroad countries, they have their GPS units, they are coming to the farm, seeing all these biosecurity measures have been taken properly or not, and then and there only they will certify the products, and those products only they will receive at their end. So biosecurity measures is very much important, and it has to be adopted by the farmer for at least for export regulations. And regarding this veterinary and medicinal products, this number of veterinary products are now being used in aqua sector. I can tell one thing, that yes, we can use these products, but we have to study the pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics of the products, and we have to study the biology of the fish and biology of our ecosystems also. Then and there only, because many these medicinal products may not work properly in case of this aqua aquatic species. Okay, so we have to develop the products which are of important to our aquaculture systems, or which can be used very nicely for our species. So, but if you will use these veterinary products directly, it may or may not work. So suppose I'll tell you the use of this ivermectin and ectomectin. If you use tons and tons of ivermectin and ectomectin for control of argolas, it is not possible to have a control and for a permanent cure or permanent control. Okay, ivermectin used this ectomectin that is used for ticks in case of cows, that is that will work nicely, but it may not work for controlling lice properly. Okay, then regarding approved and unapproved drugs, these are the approved drugs: oxytetracycline, chlorpenicol, sulfadimethoxan, and sulfamirazine. And these all the products like chlorpenicol, these all the things that has not been approved. Okay. And if you think that the approved fish drugs like chorionic gonadotropin, formalin, hydrogen peroxide, chloramine, oxytetracyclines, and tricane, chlorpenicol, all these things, they are being approved also by USFDA. And these are the low regulatory priority aquaculture, like acetic acid, calcium chloride, calcium oxide, and it's a doses also. Then carbon dioxide, fuller salt, garlic, ice, magnesium sulfate, onion, pepin, etc. They are also low regulatory priority aquaculture drugs. If you think about the risk factors in aquaculture, that is, if you think about the sustainable aquaculture development, then we have to think about the food safety and human health risks, ecological risks, as well as the environmental risks, social risks, financial risks, pathogen risks, and genetic risks. All these risk factors having the sub points, and we have we should think about all these points very seriously to have a sustainable aquaculture environment. Otherwise, our aquaculture will not. We may get a huge production this year, may not get renewed for some years also. Okay, so with regard to shared responsibility, we should protect the farm, protect the industry, protect the aquatic environment, both small and commercial scale, and cost of prevention should be is lower. And with regard to best practices guidance, so 4 Ks morning we are discussing for this 4 Ks: know your fish, know your pathogens, know your systems, and know the drugs also, contamination pathway. So these things have to be known properly, then and there only we can prescribe the medicines, or we can prescribe the drugs, or we can prevent the crops loss. Then with regard to sustainable aquaculture, if you think about the fish, definitely the use of these probiotics, a use of prebiotics, and use of both, that is symbiotics, and use of para probiotics, that is inactivated, that these probiotics, or these postbiotics, like the byproducts of probiotics are to be used, then and the disinfectants like H2O2 can be used. Then plant metabolites also can be used, and these all the things will work properly with the fish. If it will work properly with the fish, then the fish will have a good health. And once the fish will have a good health, it will, the production level will change, the production will be in a better way. If you think about the tools, capacity, and skill development, especially for decision makers, non-specialists, as well as the laboratory and field personnel, the operation manual should be available. Field and laboratory procedures, questionnaires, and recording sheets should be there. Another, data collection data. You see, documentation is a very important thing, and it should be documented for each farm, each unit, each day. All these documents should be, all these parameters should be recorded. Starting from water quality parameters, soil parameters, feeding schedule, and the application of different chemicals and different medicines also are to be noted day by day, hour by hour, hour by hour. So that has to be audited. That has to be audited. That has to be audited. And once that will be okay, then and there only the importers can give the certificate to send your product to their country. And the important role of farmers. The farmers are in the equation. So what is to be done? What is these costs are too high for small scale sector to survive. Okay. And also understanding their needs and expectations. So farmers, we should understand their needs and their expectations. Getting them involved to utilize their indigenous knowledge. So we should be involved to utilize their indigenous knowledge to get rid of the problem. Then, so, and we should give them the feedback. The farmers should give the feedbacks and updates after using the technology developed by the various research institutes, by various universities, and they should also reciprocate with the things. Then, where the farmers can go for help? Actually, the farmers, they are at the fag end, and our ultimate aim of developing the sector depends upon the development of the farmers and where they will go for help. This is Aqua One Centers that is developed by NFDB. Now, NFDB has developed several Aqua One Centers in different corners of the different states, and field schools has also been developed by NFDB. NASCA, National Center for Sustainable Aquaculture, developed by MPADA. The farmers can go these places, and also they can approach the fisheries colleges, ICR Institute, state government laboratories, blocks and district offices for several technical help, as well as discussion with regard to the development of their units. Then private clinics owned by the fisheries professionals or non-professionals also around these clinics, they can go and they can approach and for various tests. So with this, I am closing the today's talk, and I hope you have enjoyed the time. And if any queries will be there, please share, and I'll try to answer it within the specific time. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Any other queries? Majid sir? Hello.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot for being with us.
Okay, okay.
Now, if there are any questions, please ask. We have a few minutes.
Sir, this is Dr. Selvaraj from Fisheries College Ponneri.
Okay,
I just want to, this is Selvaraj from Fisheries College Ponneri, sir. I just want to know which method, diagnostic method is user friendly, sir, to farmer in terms of cost.
In terms of costs?
Yes, sir.
Actually, it depends upon the farmer's knowledge which he can use. That is
okay,
more
sir.
Important. Because suppose you may tell certain this method, he may not be able to get it. So that is more important because unless until the farmers have little basic knowledge on different diagnostic tests, so he may not use.
Thank you.
Rather, to my mind, he can approach any of these centers to have these diagnostic tests.
Thank you, sir.
Any other?
Hello.
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 Yes, sir. Hello.
Ah, boliye sir. Please.
Yes, sir, dekhiye biosensor khareed sakte hai kya
biosensor?
Biosensor khareed sakte hai kya? मार्केट में मिलेगा क्या वो?
सर अभी नहीं मिल सकता, अभी नहीं मिल सकता, बिकॉज नाउ स्टिल इट इज इन एक्सपेरिमेंटल स्टेज, एक्सपेरिमेंटल स्टेज. So it will be available maybe within a year or so, because still the model is they want to patent it, they want to patent it. So once it is patented, so once it is patented, a patent is accepted, so it may come to the market. Otherwise, now still it is in the experimental phase. Actually, biosensor, it is a very novel approach. I can tell you, it is very novel approach, and it will work definitely. It will come up very soon. Already it is developed. I have already told you, informed you. Already it is developed, but the structure is a little higher. So we have requested them to reduce it and to make it a battery operated. Okay. So it was electrically operated, and we want to make it a battery operated and a miniature model.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, sir. Any other
question, sir? Please ask.
Hello. Sir, yes, sir. When can we use CPAX? When can we use CPAX?
CPAX?
Yes, sir.
Hello. CPAX can be used, sir, as a preventive measure. CPAX too.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hello. CPAX can be used as a preventive measure also. You can use before the, once the monsoon is over, you can use it in the pond. CPAX you can use at the rate of 1 liter per hectare meter pond. Now its cost is around 1,800 per liter. Okay.
Thank
it's
you,
a product
sir.
Developed by SIPA. It is a product developed by SIPA. And now some it is patented, so it is marketed by certain agency, but it
thank
is giving
you,
very good result, I can tell you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, nice.
I think that is it for today. On behalf of the participants and on behalf of the organizing committee, I would like to extend my gratitude to you, sir. It was such a pleasure having you around with us today for the session. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us. We may join back tomorrow at 11 a.m. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks to all participants for their patient hearing, and thanks to NADCL for arranging such a beautiful series of events. You will be busy for another 21 days, perhaps. Total 21 days, already 3 days is over.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.